Okay, hi everyone. This is the third module for linear systems, and the topic of this module is subspaces and bases. So in module number two, we defined a vector space, and now we're going to follow on from that and talk about, first of all, what a subspace is, and then we're going to talk about a very important characterization of vector spaces in terms of their basis elements. So that's the topic of this module. So we'll start with the notation that we introduced last day, which is that of a vector space V over an associated field F. Okay, so let V be a vector space. And suppose now we consider a subset of V. So remember, V is a set of elements, and we've put this structure on top of it with vector addition and scalar multiplication alongside this field F. Let's suppose we take a subset. W is a subset of V. It could be equal to V, but in general, it's probably a proper subset of V. And we can ask the question, is W itself a vector space? Meaning, so the important question here is that if you take the same operations of vector addition and scalar multiplication that you've defined for V, and you use them in W. Now remember, W in general has fewer elements than V because it's a proper subset in general. If you apply those operations of vector addition and scalar multiplication to elements of W, do you stay within W? So again, that means, is W closed under vector addition and scalar multiplication? If it is, then W has a special name. It's called a subspace. All right, so W is, this is a definition. W is a subspace of V if, first, W is a subset of V, and second, W is closed under vector addition and scalar multiplication. W is closed under vector addition and scalar multiplication. And we have to be very precise here. This is vector addition and scalar multiplication that were defined for its parent space V. Using the field associated with V, which is F. Okay, so it's inheriting all of that from its parent space. And it's nice to be able to think about a subspace because it's a vector space in its own right, and so we can start to think, as we keep saying, of doing mathematics on this space. Okay, so how to check? Somebody gives you a set and they say, is this a subspace? So usually it's obvious what it's a subset of. It's usually very easy to check that. So what you usually have to do to check that it's a subspace is just check that it's closed under vector addition and scalar multiplication. Geometric interpretation, here's a simple one. If you think about the space R3, okay, so X1, X2, and X3 are my standard axes in R3, then any plane, any two-dimensional space which goes through the origin, two-dimensional plane which goes through the origin, and let's sort of draw it here and be clear that that's a plane, so it extends off to infinity, it goes through the origin. Any plane is a subspace of R3. It's not the full R3, it's only a two-dimensional space, but if it goes through the origin, then it's a subspace. It needs to go through the origin because in order to be, for this plane to be in itself a vector space, it has to have a zero element. So it's inheriting the zero element from its parent space, R3. So a plane in R3 is a subspace. You can show, and let's not actually do this proof, but you can show the following interesting facts, that if W1 is a subspace, and we'll write it of V, and W2 is a subspace of V, then if you look at the intersection, W1 intersect W2 is a subspace, that kind of makes sense intuitively, because you're looking at elements, when you look at the intersection, you're looking at elements that are in both W1 and W2. And so that's a subspace. But interestingly, if you look at the union, W1 union W2, that's not necessarily a subspace, is not necessarily a subspace. It could be, but it's not necessarily a subspace. And a nice counterexample. So an example of the union of two subspaces that's not a subspace would be, for example, let's go back to our R3 example and just think about the X1 and X2 axes. So the X1 axis is a subspace of R3. The X2 axis, here, let's use black. The X2 axis is a subspace of R3. So each of these in their own right is a subspace of R3. Yet if we look at their union, the union of two lines is just two lines. So the union of W1 and W2 is just these two lines. That is not a subspace of R3. Because if you took an element from W1 and you added it to an element of W2, you'd get something that would be in the plane defined by the axis X1 and X2. And that's not, the plane is not the union of those two lines. The union of those two lines is just those two lines. Whereas the plane would define the linear combination of elements in X1 and X2. Okay, so the intersection of subspaces are subspaces. That's easy to prove. Show it if you don't see that immediately. But the union is not. Okay, so now we can go on. So we've defined what we mean by a subspace. And now we'd like to move forward and define what we mean by bases, a basis of a vector space. So let's keep our vector space up there, V. And let's define, first of all, the property of linear independence. So we have our vector space V. And suppose we had a set of vectors. We're to consider a set of elements of V, a set of vectors, V1, V2, up to, say, Vp. So I'm choosing p vectors from V, and I'm going to look at that set of vectors. So each of the Vi's belong to V. This set of vectors is said to be linearly independent if the following holds, if and only if, alpha 1 V1 plus alpha 2 V2 plus alpha p Vp is equal to the zero vector, if that equality implies that all of those alphas are equal to zero. And here, remember, when we perform this operation, these alphas are coming from our field F. So what this is saying is that you can't, if you have this set of vectors, you can't write any of these vectors as a linear combination of the others. There's no way to do that, because the only way that this equality with the right-hand side being zero holds is if those alphas are equal to zero. Conversely, we say that that set of vectors is, so that's the definition of linear independence, they're called linearly dependent. Is linearly dependent if and only if the following hold. There exist field elements, so scalars, alpha 1, alpha 2, up to alpha p, not all zero. So one or some subset of them, or could be zero, could be non-zero. And these are belonging to the field, such that alpha 1 V1 plus alpha 2 V2 plus alpha p Vp is equal to zero. The zero vector, remember. Okay, so implicitly in this we see that if the set of vectors is linearly dependent, then you can write one or some of those vectors as a linear combination of the other ones. So in some sense, one or some of them are redundant in that set. So linear independence is important, and it's used, it's central to the definition of a very important set of vectors called the basis set, or a basis set. So again, with respect to this vector space, let's define the basis. So if suppose we had a set of vectors, I'm going to call them b, b1, b2, up to bn, say. This set of vectors is called a basis. It's called a basis of V if the following holds. The first condition, so there's two conditions that have to be satisfied. The first is that the set B spans V, and the second is that B is a linearly independent set. Linearly independent. Okay, so in order to span a set, so what does that mean, it spans V? That means that any vector in V, if you take any vector V in our set V, it can be written as a linear combination of the basis elements. So any, let's write it like this, any V in V can be written as V is equal to some linear combination of basis elements, alpha 1 b1 plus alpha 2 b2 up to alpha n bn. Okay, so this makes sure that the set is big enough to, it's big enough so that it can adequately represent any vector in V. The second condition makes sure that that set is small enough so that you're not including redundant vectors. So that set being linearly independent ensures that you don't just keep adding vectors which could be dependent on the previous set of vectors that you defined. So this sort of makes sure it's big enough, and this one makes sure that it's not too big. And then finally, we define, with respect to a basis, we define a coordinate representation. So once you've got a vector space and you've chosen a basis for that vector space, then you define the coordinates of any vector to be these scalars that multiply the basis elements to be able to get the vector itself. So here, for a vector in our vector space, if we write it, we know that if we have a basis, by definition, we can write it as a linear combination of the basis elements, alpha n, bn. The coordinates of the basis for that vector are the alpha i's. So alpha I equals 1 up to n, are called the coordinates of V with respect to, WRT is with respect to the basis B. Okay, a couple of important things to note, that you can have many possible bases, an infinite number of bases for a vector space. You can see that by definition, you could just look at some linear combination of these vectors, and then show that they're linearly independent, then you've got another basis. So there's an infinite number of basis sets for a given vector space. However, if you have a set that has a finite number of basis elements, then the number of basis elements in any basis is going to be constant. And that's called the dimension of the vector space. In this case, V has dimension n, because there are n basis elements. Any other basis that I choose for V is going to have n elements. That's the dimension. And so we talk about finite dimensional vector spaces. That refers to the fact that there are a finite number of basis elements in the basis for that vector space. And the other point to note is that once you've chosen a basis, then for any vector in that space, the set of coordinates is unique. So given a basis, any vector in the space is uniquely defined in terms of its coordinates. That's easy to prove. And it's easy to prove just by assuming that it's not, assuming you have two coordinate sets and deriving a contradiction with the linear independence of the basis. Okay, so we've talked about we've talked about subspaces of vector spaces, and we've talked about linear independence and dependence, and through that we've defined the important concept of a basis of a vector space. Okay, and we'll conclude with some simple examples, and we'll just sort of think of some very simple things. So the first thing is, suppose somebody gives you the space R3, so R3 over the field of real numbers. What's a basis for R3? So the standard basis that we typically think of are the axes in the diagram that I just erased. So we can think about a basis for this as being the what we call the standard basis elements, which are the unit vectors in R3. And there's three of them. So it's a three-dimensional space. Suppose I asked you to come up with a basis for the following vector space. So R3 by 3 over R is the set of all 3 by 3 matrices with real elements. Okay, so each element of the vector space has 9 real numbers associated to it for the matrix elements. And I asked you to come up with a basis for that space. Then we could think about, again, the standard basis elements. So the standard basis elements would be the matrix that would be 3 by 3 matrices that have ones in each of the alternating spaces. So there's 9 basis elements in R3 by 3. And that's the standard basis. Finally, we can think about, we ended last day or last module talking about vector spaces, which are function spaces. And so we can start to think now about bases for function spaces and how we would define those. And so again, this is something that we'll bring up throughout the modules, but what's important here is to think about a vector space structure and about the definition of or some really defining concept of a vector space, which is the basis of that vector space. That's a way of, as we can see here, once you have the basis, it's a way of generating all vectors in that space. Okay, so in this module, we'll do a bit of a recap. We've talked about subspaces. We've talked about properties of linear dependence and independence. We've defined bases. We've defined coordinates of bases. And we've thought about some simple examples. Okay, so next module, we're going to move on to talk about linearity, linear independence and dependence, and I've been using this terminology of linear combination, what that really means. Okay, thanks everyone.